Hi, I'm Dr. Jon Gibson from the University of Manchester. I'll be talking about the Determinants of Primary Care workforce variation in England. The research presented here has been funded by the National Institute for Health Research, and the views expressed are those of the authors, not necessarily those of the NIHR, the Department of Health and Social Care. There's some background. Healthcare need is increasing, and there's an expectation this need will be met, in part by the transfer of services from hospital to primary care. However, there are significant concerns about the future of primary care, with a decline in the number of GPs and several unresolved issues related to recruitment and retention. The Primary Care Workforce Commission from 2015 recommended that skill mix changes in primary care were a potential solution to this, i.e. an increase in the employment of a more diverse range of non-GP practitioners. In the Conservative Party manifesto, an additional 6,000 doctors were promised to general practice and 6,000 additional primary care professionals. So how has the workforce changed over the most recent years? Well, in this chart, we can see this primary care workforce divided into three groups: GPs, nurses, and those staff who are categorised as direct patient care. These are staff such as pharmacists, paramedics, physician associates, healthcare assistants. As you can see, the top line is GPs, and what we observed is a slight decrease in the number of GPs working in primary care over this period, followed by a slight increase, or very marginal change. And what we can see for nurses and direct patient care is we've seen a steady but marginal increase over time in the number of full-time equivalents employed in primary care in England for these groups. Underlying that previous graph, however, is an increasing patient list size those staff need to treat. In this graph, we have got mean full-time equivalents per 1,000 patients. So this takes into account the fact that the patient list size is increasing. As we can see, in each year, these bars are divided between the different provider types shown in the legend at the bottom. What this graph shows is there's a steady decline in the number of GPs per 1,000 patients, that is GP partners, salary GPs and locums. And what we see right at the end of these bars at the right hand side is there's a steady increase in the number of physician associates, pharmacists, physiotherapists and paramedics who are employed in primary care in England. And so we're seeing a steady increase in the involvement of these new worker types over time. But we're also seeing variation between regions in England. As you can see in this graph, areas such as London, Northwest London, North Central and East London have got fewer staff per patient over all the staff types, whereas areas such as the Northeast and South West have a greater number of staff per 1,000 patients. And what you can also see within these bars, the different variation between regions, the types of staff who are employed. So for instance, Kent, Surrey and Sussex and Thames Valley have slightly more direct patient care per 1,000 patients compared with North Central and East London. And so we're interested in understanding what types of practices are employing these new types of staff. So one of the first things that we can do is plot out the geographic location of where these practices are who are employing these new practitioner types. So on these maps, we have the locations of practices who've employed paramedics, pharmacists, physician associates, physiotherapists. And this was using data from June 2019. As you can see for the paramedics, these are mostly being employed in practices in the south of England. For pharmacists, there is a much more even geographic spread, although they tend to be focused around the areas of high population, such as London, the Midlands, the Northwest. Physician associates, there's far fewer practices who have these employed, and they tend to be focused around the larger cities, such as London, Birmingham, Manchester. And physiotherapists, there's far fewer of these employed, and they are fairly evenly distributed around the country. These maps are interesting to show us the rollout of these new provider types across the country However, they don't really tell us much about the types of practices who are employing these new worker types. Our research question for this project was, given the change in workforce structure and the regional variation, what are the practice characteristics that are associated with this workforce composition and employment of new roles? And so for this research, we've looked at a number of factors that may influence the variation in workforce. We've looked at the total number of patients that a practice has on their list, the age profile of those patients that they treat, the practice contract type, whether this is a GMS contract, PMS or APMS. We've looked at the payments that the practices receive, specifically through the Minimum Practice Income Guarantee, MPIG. We've looked at whether the practices are offer dispensing services or extended access services. We've looked at the rurality of these practices and the deprivation of a patient list size. We've looked at the distance these practices are to the nearest hospital in kilometres and the distance these practices are to the nearest medical school, which may influence the supply of doctors. And we've also looked at unavoidable geographic cost variation through examining the practice's market forces factor. So I'll be presenting some regression results, and on this slide I show the three dependent variables for the regressions. Firstly, we have the practice GP full-time equivalents, secondly the nurse full-time equivalents of the practice, and finally the full-time equivalents of the direct patient care staff at the practice. Some descriptive statistics are shown at the bottom. As you can tell, these variables are highly skewed, and so in order to account for that, take a transformation, specifically the inverse hyperbolic sine transformation. Given the transformation of the dependent variables affects the interpretation of the coefficients, I'll be focusing our description of the results solely on the sine and on the significance of the parameters. These three columns show the three regression models. Given the likely correlation between the error terms, these three regression models have been estimated using seemingly unrelated regression. Our first variables of interest are the total patient list size at the practice. In order to look at these in greater detail, we've included a square and a cube term. And the relationship here is that the larger the number of patients that a practice has, the greater number of staff across all of the three groups the practice employs. The second group of variables that we've examined in this model are the distance to the nearest hospital that a practice is, as well as the distance to the nearest medical school. We've included these because we were interested in examining whether practices who were further away from hospitals had to employ a different type of workforce. As you can see in the column one, the GPs, both of these variables are significant and negative. The further a practice is away from a hospital or a medical school, less GPs per thousand, less GPs that these practices employ. However, the coefficients for the other two columns are positive and significant. Further away a hospital, the greater the number of nurses and direct patient care staff that these practices employ. The coefficient for the proportion of patients over 65 variable is significantly positive across all three of these workforce models, indicating that the larger the proportion of patients over 65, the more staff the practice employs across all three of these worker types. Coefficients here for the variable MPIG, which is the Minimum Practice Income Guarantee per patient, are positive across all three worker type models, significant for GPs, direct patient care, indicating the larger payments the practice receive, the more GPs and direct patient care staff that the practice employs. Rurality is a dummy variable, taking the value 1. Practice located in a rural location. This is positive and significant across all three worker types, indicating that more rural practices employ more staff across all three worker groups. The market forces factor, however, is positive and significant for GPs, whereas it's negative and significant for nurses and direct patient care. This indicates that practices that are located in areas with higher unavoidable geographic costs have relatively more GPs but less nurses and less direct patient care. This indicates that there is a compositional element going on related to unavoidable geographic cost variation. The coefficient of income deprivation is positive and significant across all three provider types, indicating that practices who have patients located in more income deprived areas employ more workers across all three. The coefficient on practices who have a GMS contract is negative and significant across all three staff groups, indicating that GMS practices employ fewer staff relative to practices who are on other contracts such as PMS or APMS. The coefficients on dispensing practices are positive and significant, indicating that dispensing practices employ more of all three staff groups relative to practices who are non-dispensing. And additionally, practices who offer extended access services employ more GPs, and more direct patient care staff relative to practices who do not offer extended access services. And so just to summarise, we've found several potentially supply side influencing factors, such as a distance away from hospital and medical school. These practices have more nurses and direct patient care staff, but relatively less GPs. We've also found practices who have higher market forces factor, i.e. higher unavoidable geographic linked costs, employ more GPs, but less nurses and less direct patient care staff. This is potentially indicative that GPs are more able to live in more expensive areas compared to nurse or direct patient care, or it's more desirable for them to live in those areas. Although practices in those areas are more inclined to hire more GPs. We've also found some potential demand side factors, such as the more patients a practice has over the age of 65, the more staff that they employ from all staff groups, and the practices who have patients in more income deprived areas are also more likely to employ staff from all of the different group types. Practices who receive larger payments through the minimum practice income guarantee payments have also got more staff employed across all the different groups, and as well, practices who receive payments for offering dispensing services, extended hour services, and who are on non-GMS practice contracts have more staff full-time equivalents across all of the three workforce groups. Our analysis is ongoing, but these early results provide some insights into the demand and side factors that are associated and potentially influencing the workforce composition of practices in England. Thank you for listening to our early research. If you have any questions, please leave them below. Thank you.